This is I'm Richa Burman. I'm a commissioning editor at Penguin, and this is Usha Alexander, author and anthropologist. We have just published this lovely book, The Legend of Veera Nara. It's an epic saga of war and peace, which draws on the history, myths, and legends of India. And it's a thrilling adventure, full of political intrigue and a lot of adventure, etc. So we're delighted to have you here, Usha.
Thank you for having me.
So, you know, there's a right in the beginning of the book, the central protagonist Shanti, who's a princess, she travels to this port away from her kingdom. She's a teenager and she is quite awestruck by the sights that she sees there. So what was that, how it was for you? You spent, Usha mostly grew up in the US. So was it like that for you when you came to India for the first time and traveled around?
In some ways, perhaps, not exactly. I mean, I think Shanti grew up in a very different world than I grew up. And she came from a small kingdom a little distance from the coast. And of course, in her world, there was no media, there were no photographs. So whatever she knew of the world was just what came into her local area, into her kingdom. And she wouldn't have had an idea about much of the world. So when she travels to the coast and she sees like the ocean for the first time and different animals and people who've come from across the sea, for her, that's something completely new and unexpected. And I think it for her, it's a revelation. So, and I think for me, of course, it was different. For one thing, I was younger. The first time I came to India, I was about 8 years old. That was in 1972. Even India was very different at the time.
Hardly any cars on the streets, I'm sure.
Yeah, there were essentially no cars to speak of. Yeah. The people were riding tongas and rickshaws. Actually, that was new. Yes. But I had seen photographs, and you know, I grew up in an Indian family, so many things about India were not that foreign or new or unimagined. In the same way that the world outside of her kingdom would have been unimagined or unimaginable to Shanti. So the things that took me by surprise were the kinds of things that people didn't talk about or didn't appear in photographs. So not like the great sculptures and art and temples, but ordinary things like you mentioned, there are no cars on the street. I grew up in a place where everybody has a car, and people instead riding tongas. And I remember monkeys everywhere, and actually all of this nature being part of the city, that was something that was very different compared to the United States, where nature is very much kept at bay. So in that way, these were the kinds of things that surprised me, maybe in a similar way, where you think it changes your idea of how the world is or what's possible in the world or what a society might.
So nature is kind of intruding on the city. It's not excluded.
Yeah, there's a right. Different negotiation. I think it's still true in India. There's a different negotiation between nature and urban spaces. Again, that's also changing as the cities get bigger and more crowded. But it still feels
like we complain about the cows on the streets, that they come in the way of traffic.
Yes, which, you know, can be irritating, but it's also interesting and fascinating. Having goats are so cute. I mean seriously, I actually had a friend visit me here some years ago, and he just loves the fact that there were goats everywhere.
We have a lot of street dogs as well. I mean, that
yes,
is also,
they're also cute. I love the street dogs.
So tell us something, why pick an ancient period to set the story in?
I don't think when I started out with the initial ideas or the initial spark of the story in my head, I don't think that I had started out with the idea of making it an ancient story. I feel more like, because of the things I was doing at the time, the story came to life in an ancient world. We were living in India at the time when I first started to write, and we were traveling around, we were visiting all of the very ancient sites, and I was reading Indian history, and it's a very rich tapestry in the ancient Indian world, because there was a lot of diversity. There was there was global trade going on, so it was a time, there was a lot of foment of ideas, goods and people and ideas coming from across the sea and going across the sea. And there were there was a lot of diversity in the societies that existed at the time, at many different levels of political, different political structures. You had huge empires in some parts, and then there were small kingdoms. There were people still living as nomads in the forests. So all of these things were going on at once, and it was a very rich, full place for the characters to find a niche and set up home. And then, I was looking at ancient art, sculptures and things like that, and all of the little details that would come out in the art, which, would bring up more questions about who were these people, what was this time like, and in some of them you would find little details that were very intriguing, like I remember one, they're men in a little boat and they're rowing, and it just made me wonder, like, who are these people, what was the sculptor trying to depict here, where are they going, and just the details of how people dressed. In some of the sculptures you can actually make out the designs that were meant to be on the cloth of the antharios that they wore, which covered the lower half of their bodies. So all of these details and questions and fragments and all of this was going on in my head at the same time as, other questions that I was just wondering about the world. And the story unfolded in this ancient world.
The antharios is something that all the characters wear, and I think what I remember, what took me by surprise when I first read the story, was that they wear nothing on their torsos. Even the women are bare-chested. And they wear only beads, and the kind of beads that they wear defines which class they belong to, whether they are from the lower classes, the servants, or they are royalty. The kind of beads they wear shows, depicts that, and nothing else.
So the bead thing, that was something I made up as just part of that particular society. I haven't read that anywhere, but certainly if you look at the ancient art, very consistently, all the people wear only covering on the bottom half and little to nothing on top.
Which is what we've also depicted on
in
this,
the cover. Yes.
On the cover. But that's a lot of research for you to delve into, because, I mean, you have to recreate an entire world that we don't know about, that we are very unfamiliar with.
We have
no idea what this world is.
Yeah, that was one of the hardest things about writing this story. And not so much like the research. I mean, I didn't sit down in a library and pore over things. I read a lot and traveled a lot and paid attention to details. But trying to bring it to life and recreate it in a way that it was recognizable and rich enough to be plausible. I tried to stick very much to the, realistic details of the period. So, like, one of the things, there are several descriptions of food in the book, and the food descriptions, they sort of suggest whether the person is rich or poor. So, like, the wealthier people in the book, they have more access to milk and ghee and fried foods. But I had to keep in mind that many of the foods that we think of today as Indian food, many of the ingredients were not available in the ancient world in India. So there were no potatoes, there were no chili peppers, there were no tomatoes. Many of the fruits that are common today were not there. So I had to do a little bit of research about what was there. You know, there was rice, many kinds of lentils, jackfruits, drumsticks, eggplants. And I had to also imagine that they would have eaten foods that we don't eat anymore, that have fallen out of the diet. So particularly with the people who live in the forest, their diet consists, it's more around palm pith and tubers of an unfamiliar sort, and fish, of course.
Also meat? I mean, they would also be hunting for fish, I think there's one of the things that this girl goes and hunts, and for Shanti it's an experience that she actually kills a fish with her own hands, and that's makes her feel quite terrible.
Yeah.
But she loves to eat it.
Yeah.
So she eats fish. That's something that her lover kind of confronts her with, that you killed a fish and yet you want to call yourself nonviolent, etc. Well, it's one of the things. So tell us about some interesting characters and legends that you drew upon from India's rich traditions.
I tried to stay true to some of the motifs that are actually found in like deep Indian history, and not be exact, or not to depict the mythologies of the gods and characters that are very popular today, but to imagine back 2,000 years and create local legends and gods and deities that plausibly might have existed in some small area back in those days. And so, like, I know that there have been all across India the snake god, or snakes have appeared in folklore and legend, and they are usually associated with fecundity and also, I think, with rootedness in a place, with land. And of course there have been river gods all across India, goddesses. So I kind of took these things and mixed it up a little bit. I invented a goddess for the people of Veeranara, who is a river god. She's also the goddess of fish, and in that way is associated with fecundity and also plenty, prosperity, and also with the land. You know, the confluence of these two rivers, and this is their homeland. This is their original land. So, and then there's also a male god that I made up, who has certain aspects that might be suggestive of Shiva. He has like a third eye that opens and he destroys things. He's also associated with cattle. He has a companion who's a bull. And he is also associated with the forest and with hunting and wild game. But he's not identical to Shiva. He's like a suggestion or a proto-Shiva.
Right.
And then beyond the mythology, some of the plot points in the book are taken or suggested by things that actually happened in India. So like one thing that you notice when you read Indian history is that in the past, rulers would come up, a kingdom would develop, and as the rulers became more powerful, particularly if they came from more subaltern origins, they were interested in legitimizing themselves by claiming a Kshatriya lineage. So they would invent a lineage which claimed that they had descended from the sun or from the moon, like the Chandanas did that. So there's that kind of thing. Then also at that time, you know, settled people, more and more of the land was getting settled, cleared with kingdoms. And meanwhile, there were still people living a very ancient lifestyle of gathering and hunting in forests, and these people were coming into conflict. And the people in the settled societies seemed to think of the forest dwellers, they considered them a threat. They thought of them as, you know, dangerous, like Rakshasas.
Yeah, that's a very interesting part of mythology, who's seen as who, and you know, identity is so important.
Yes. Yeah. So that was part of what I wanted to capture, is how people relate to their identities based on the stories they tell of their own history, and how these stories can come into conflict. And I think it happens more and more strongly between peoples who actually share
a similar,
similar stories, but not identical.
Similar identities makes me think of, you know, how with women it's never very clear because they marry into some other household and their identity changes. So to have a female protagonist for the book, why did you, how did it come about?
I think when I first started writing, I was just drawn to the character of Shanti. I started to admire her, so she became prominent. Then I also thought it was interesting to tell this story from the perspective of someone who is, she's very interested and very invested in the events of the story and in what happens, but she doesn't have very much control over it. She doesn't have any formal power. And so she's an onlooker, but she's not a bystander. She does direct or influence the events. But she also is a little bit removed and is able to have a larger vision, I think, than maybe some of the characters who are immediately caught up in decision making.
Just distance.
Yeah, a little bit of distance, but not too much.
Not too much.
And yeah, and not hands on. With respect to what you said about women going off, marrying into another household, another thing I wanted to do was, I was imagining a pre-patriarchal society. So in India and elsewhere in the world, before, in pre-agricultural times, there were more matrilineal societies which were not strongly patriarchal. And many of those have gone away in India as elsewhere. But so I wanted to depict that. And so the forest society in the book is a matrilineal society, and the kingdom that Shanti comes from is a society in transition. That, so they still have some vestiges of their matrilineal structures, but they're moving towards patriarchy. That was interesting to me to explore.
And so how did it affect the story that, you know, it, a woman of ancient times with all these things around her, how did it change the story or make the story the way it turned out to be?
I think having Shanti as the protagonist brought a number of things to the storytelling. For one thing, a lot of times these kinds of stories about, you know, epic conflicts are told from the point of view of a leader or classical hero, warrior, and they tend to revolve around a certain idea of leadership or battles and, you know, muscle and that kind of
battle.
Valor, yes, bravery and battle. And so Shanti isn't like that. But I think she is a very brave character, so it's a different kind of bravery that she has. She never fights anybody, she never goes into battle. But she confronts the unknown with a lot of boldness, I think, a lot of courage. And she uses her wit and her heart, her compassion, to confront things and deal with the situation. So it's a different kind of bravery that I think it allowed me to be able to explore. Also, I think Shanti talks a lot about her own fears and her own vulnerabilities. And not only her own, but all of the people around her. Her way of describing things, that's one of the aspects she pays attention to. And even for the warriors, she reveals their vulnerability. And I think one of the things that it shows is how much, even for these brave men, their vulnerability is as much a part of them and is as significant to the choices they make and the flow of events as anything to do with bravery.
And this is interesting that this comes through in th- through an ancient story, because even now we are seeing in contemporary popular culture that there's a kind of reclaiming of the vulnerable for men. You know, the soft father, the you know, somebody who can just stay at home, be a house husband. That's a new terminology going around, and men do want to choose to just stay at home and take care of the house. That's a new trend, one can say. Vulnerability makes me think of you know, how we are all vulnerable irrespective of gender when we are in love, and love is really central to the story. So why was it important for you for love to be central, and what are your thoughts on love?
Well, I think love is very important and central. I mean, not just in, I mean, it's in some way going to be essential in any story, I think, because well, in this story, for Shanti, falling in love with Narun is a life-changing event for her. He comes from a very different world, and falling in love with him opens her up. It enables her to, it challenges her to go out in the world and be brave in a way that she didn't know she could be. It enables her to discover her own strength that she didn't know she had. And it also becomes for her a point of conflict itself. And it, this, the conflicts around her love and her valuing this love, both of these things help, they determine the course of events. And not only for Shanti, but I think for several of the characters in the story, they, they're motivated by love. But, and I think I wanted to examine that, this idea that history is shaped ultimately by human passions, whether it's individually, by a person who is in power or who has a lot of influence, or whether it's collectively through the passions that ordinary people have that inspire them. For instance, when soldiers go off to war, they do it for the love of their country, for the love of their community or the family that they're hoping to protect. And, you know, people learn, people challenge themselves because of love, often, to see things in a way that they wouldn't have ever tried because a loved one sees things differently or has made choices that they don't understand. So, and I wouldn't confine it to romantic love, but there are many different kinds of love, and I think they're all equally important. They don't all get as much press, I suppose, but the love of one's family, or the kind of love that holds a community together, these are also very powerful forms of love. And I mean, in that way, I think I would say that it's, love is one of the most potent forces in the world.
Indeed. So tell us something about your writing process. Do you have a plot structure in mind before you begin? You have characters laid out, or does it just unfold while you're writing?
Yeah, it's not really a process,
okay.
I would say. I think it's really just more that I get fascinated by or stuck on certain questions or thoughts or bits of stories that come to me. Something will stick in my head, something I read or a place I visited or a person I know, particularly if someone I know has done something, made a choice that I find difficult to understand, and then I'm very interested in trying
to
understand.
Put them in the book.
Yes, 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 it happens. Or a character trait that I find baffling that I want to understand. And all of these things, they just kind of seep into me and they, you know, float around for a while, and little by little fragments of stories develop, characters, and it can actually take years for some of these bits to sort of tangle themselves together into a larger story that might become a novel. And only then would I maybe start to try writing something. And after you start writing, the characters do unexpected things, they change, they get deeper, the situation grows more complex, and then it slowly develops into a rewriting.
Okay. And one has to be careful around writers, because you don't know when you're going to be created into a character who's not so savory. So you, this particular book, you spent nearly a decade writing it, and in the meantime you held a job at Apple. So how much did the story change, and how much did you change in this long number of years?
Yeah, the story changed a lot. It is in a very different form than when it started. And some of the characters didn't exist at the beginning, and they sort of came on the scene and became prominent. Other characters that I had intended to be more prominent ended up fading into the background. They made their own decisions, and the whole book kind of changed in different ways. The structure of the story as it is now, where it's a conversation, it's a sage speaking to a monk, and she's telling him the story of her life and reflecting on her youth. That framing device that I was years into writing before, that struck me. So, and then I had tried other ways of doing it too, which ended up getting thrown in the dustbin. So, it changed a lot. And I, of course, changed a lot in 10 years over midlife. I was living in India when I started writing, and went back to the United States and joined Apple. I had worked for Apple before, and I left it, and I went back. And it was a very demanding job. So one of the things that happened is that the 10 years of writing were not 10 years of steady and focused writing, but I would go for months at a time without any space to work on the book. 3 months, 6 months, I wouldn't even open it and look at it. But I think the story was always in the back of my head, and it was developing and growing. But I was very, at that time, also very involved in my life at Apple and Silicon Valley. And then I left there and came back, so.
Okay. How was it working at Apple?
It was, in many ways, it was a lot of fun. It was very demanding. It was high stress environment. It was an interesting time, an interesting place. I think it was fun, on the one hand, I think because there was this awareness that you were in this nexus of creativity, and you know, the future technology of the world came out of this area, not just Apple, but being in Silicon Valley and the culture of that place. But I think more than that, for me, it was just, I met a lot of really wonderful people at Apple who are still my friends. And even among the ones I didn't know that well, everyone was just very smart and creative, and it was fun. You know, many of them were musicians, writers, artists, and it was fun to get to go and work on projects with these guys.
Okay. Interesting. Somehow, I'm wondering if you, did you ever write by hand, or did you always type the story type from the beginning?
I think I started out typing, because I started typing very early.
And Apple, a cutting edge of technology, so.
Yeah, well, by the time I was working at Apple, I'm sure I not held a pen and used by
pen. In fact, Apple, like, reading your trajectory, I remember being really fascinated that you have a very interesting trajectory of going from different subjects, and you were also interested in teaching at one point. You did teach, and you really enjoyed it. So tell us a bit about your transition happened from.
Yeah, I started out in science, and I loved science. I was a chemist and a molecular biologist, and I still love science. I think it's a very powerful way of understanding the world and asking questions, and not just because it is a way of creating technology, but I think it's a very meaningful way of engaging with the world and understanding the world. But as I got further into science, I began to feel that it didn't answer everything that I was curious about. That there are entire realms of inquiry that science has nothing satisfying to say about. And like, just what does it mean to be human? You know, how do we understand our life and living? And that's not an area for science. So I switched to anthropology. And anthropology was also endlessly fascinating. I learned a lot in anthropology about what it means to be human and, you know, human diversity, human potential, where we came from, how we got here, you know, different human societies. But at some point that too began to feel like it wasn't really getting at the things that I was wondering about. And I wanted to be able to, I guess, with this understanding that I had learned about the world, I wanted to be able to, you know, jump off from what we know of the world and look at the things that cannot be known and imagine what are some answers to some of these more slippery questions. And that makes you, I think, a storyteller. Because I think that ultimately stories are a way of communicating knowledge and information and understanding about the world, but not in a way that appeals merely to logic or reason or emotion. It's not just your heart or your head, but stories make knowledge more like immersive, like an experience. So you step into a story. And you learn about the world in a different way, or you explore questions in a different way. And I mean, at least at their best, I think that's what stories do for us.
Yeah, like this book as well, I mean, it's a world of its own, but it's set in an ancient period, but then you do see a lot of parallels with the present times, and you sort of identify with certain characters or certain characters' traits, and then you wonder, what would I have done in that situation? How would I have behaved? And that makes you sort of delve deeper into human character, I suppose. Let me just ask if we've got any questions from readers. Okay. So this was a really wonderful discussion. And I hope you all will enjoy reading the book. Thank you for tuning in. It's a beautiful love story. Whenever you get the time, do pick up your copy. Thank you.
Thank you.